Okay, that's the end of the time. I want to move on to quadrant two. And you can always go back to the quadrant if you want to reevaluate yourself. Project management. And we're going to repeat this recipe. So you'll get familiar with this bouncing ball a little bit. Quadrant two is what I call the project management quadrant for product ownership. What are some activities that I think of as being quadrant two activities? Chartering, project chartering, starting a project or a product initiative, establishing mission vision, establishing vision for the team, establishing team dynamics, chartering, what I think of as traditional PMI project chartering, but with an agile twist. If you want a good chartering book, there's something called Liftoff. I think it's Agile Liftoff, a wonderful book that talks about chartering from an agile perspective. There's a second edition of it. I forget the authors. They'll come to me. They're two famous agile coaches, consultants. But Project Liftoff or Agile Liftoff is the trigger is Liftoff. Short and long-term planning. So look ahead, what I think of as look ahead, architectural look ahead, feature look ahead, trying to do not the layers below road mapping, if you will, a release management planning. How are we going to deploy this? Deployment factors, getting it into operations, DevOps deployments, communication to customers. Expectation management and communication happens at this level as well. So there's an expectation management in quadrant one. I think that's more holistic to stakeholder expectations and high level milestones and goals. Here, it's more so, hey, we're off the rails in our quarterly release. This release train is 20 to 30% behind schedule. What are we going to do? We're going to have to make some pivoting decisions. So expectations management I'll use safe terms at a release train level. At that level, across functional dependencies, not managing them the way maybe a project manager would do, but being aware of cross team dependencies and also managing those dependencies in the backlog streams that hit multiple teams at scale. One of the things that I think a lot of organizations struggle with at scale is cross team dependencies. And usually the reaction is to put the burden on the team to manage those dependencies. But I actually think there's an opportunity earlier when the product team is composing the backlogs and distributing them to team to team to team to team, when that group of product owners is orchestrating how we're going to decompose the work, they can be much more, they can be thoughtless, which increases dependencies, or they can be thoughtful, which can reduce dependencies. So it's not just a team thing. I think it's don't dump a mess into the lap of the team that they have to, like a spaghetti that they have to sort out. Be thoughtful at a product level and have the team be thoughtful about how they mitigate those dependencies. Sprinkling milestones, risk mitigation, regulatory concerns, budget, tracking, traceability would be in the project management sort of at this level, at this quadrant. This is not an... Again, I'm not giving you an exhaustive list. I'm giving you ideas of what I think fall here, and then I'm going to ask you to map as well. The one thing in this quadrant that I want you to think of, and I think you'll get a lot of traction out of this as a product owner, is I want you to think of your backlogs, whether it's a portfolio-level backlog, a program-level backlog, product-level backlog, or an individual team-level backlog. I want you to start thinking of threads of activity or threads of responsibility that go through your backlog. The metaphor that I talked about it, I think, in the initial edition of my PO book. I'm in the third edition now. So I wrote it 10 years ago. So I've been talking about this metaphor for 10 to 12 years. I think folks trivialize. So a not thoughtful backlog has just features. Sometimes I call it featureitis. The backlog just contains features and there's no nuance to it. I think that's a pretty easy backlog, but a pretty thoughtless backlog. And it's not very well balanced. I want you to look at the backlog and say, you should be able to say, hey, how are we delivering value in the backlog? You should be able to look at a backlog and say, how are features unfolding to our customers? You should be able to look at a backlog and say, how are we mitigating risk, technical risk, program risk, customer discovery risk, in the backlog. I should be able to see regulatory concerns in the backlog. I should be able to see design and architectural unfolding and de-risking of that in the backlog. I know I'm adding a lot of things, but that's a backlog you should look at as a rich tapestry of concerns that unfolds. It's really unhealthy to look at it as a series of prioritized stories that you just slap together and throw out and people make sense of. There's a little bit more nuance. I prefer a lot more nuance to how we're unfolding the work, how we're unfolding the story, if you will, of the feature set. And this metaphor helps with that. And it's a project management metaphor. So put that in the back of your mind and in your thinking. So we're going to do the same thing. We're going to take a minute pause. I want you to think about quadrant two. The theme is project management stuff. I gave you some ideas. Now I want you to look at your context and make your list and then do the same thing. How much time are you spending on that stuff to 10% clarity? All right. So you got a minute. And again, if you're not even in product ownership, then just take a wild guess of what, based on where you're at in your organization, take a guess and take an organizational view. You'll get some value out of it that way. If you have some extra time, go to quadrant one. Balance across these. Just keep working. And we're done.